Roll camera, action.
So Dr. Arundhati, firstly let me say it's such a pleasure to get this time and have this opportunity of interacting with you. There are few people who leave a mark through their sheer perseverance and skills and the style of living, and you have been one such person, and we are really really honored to profile you in the series of Educators Making a Difference.
Thank you so much. Thanks for your kind words. But you know what? I have been passionate about education and I believe in lifelong learning. I'm a good learner and then a good teacher. That's what I feel about me. Like, you know, thank you so much for your appreciation.
So wonderful. So I guess let's set the ball rolling. I just wanted to get your perspective. You have such rich body of experience behind you. What outcome, according to you, education should drive, especially in this changing world?
See, education is transformation of a human being. First of all, I want the children to become good human beings that we cannot compromise at all. And secondly, now with the global awareness, the entire globe is shrunken into one world, one small village. So what happens is, like, today it is not about my country or my school or my, I mean, we can't live in those layers now. It is equipping our kids for global citizenship. So that is what is the true aim of education in the real sense. So a child should be so very well equipped that they can go to any nook and corner of the world and lead a successful life and a happy life. Success, I don't measure in terms of money or assets or your earning and all that, but you know, be happy and be contented. So that is where the skills come into picture. So that's what I believe in true education.
Okay. So if I have to just add on to this and say that, how would you tangibilize and define quality education?
Alright. See, quality education is information, of course, we require. We cannot say, you know, like, only playway method. Many people, like, sometimes they misunderstand what is playway method. It's not that. Education has to be content driven, no doubt about it. Knowledge base has to be built very properly, and that edifice of knowledge we can erect only if the basic core values are in place. So we need to teach children the basic values of life on which the education has to be built according to whatever years of learning they take place and all that. So say, for example, core value of honesty. What is it, honesty? Or, you know, being compassionate. So what is the difference between being compassionate and sympathizing somebody? You know, like, I don't believe in sympathy. You become, you know, you have to have that empathy. You feel for others. So these are the things which are basis. And of course, information has to be transmitted. But again, any subject what we select, it should have a proper vertical and horizontal articulation so that the children are learning and they are remembering what they have learnt. It's not just for cramming up and getting your you know, degrees or getting your first class and all that, but how much you are getting knowledge and how you are applying, that matters a lot to me. Like, you know, in any situation or anywhere, like how you actually apply the knowledge, that's what is true education.
Good to know that. So if I move on to my second question, you know, everyone talks about new age skills in bot 4.0, the industrial era that's come, the new revolution that's happening. What are the critical skills which you want your students to be equipped with, especially since you mentioned about knowledge and ability to apply that knowledge essentially translates to skills?
Yes. See, now if you go to see right from the beginning, right from the days of Chanakya, we have been equipping children in all the skills. Now when something comes from the West in a very well packaged way, we feel wow, like it has come. It's not that way. We have been teaching. Indian education system in fact is the best in the world, I would say. You know, and we have contributed so much to that, to the world, like whether it is mathematics or whether it is languages and our Sanskrit you take, so that is it. But now coming back to, like, you know, what skills you want to develop. See, children, according to me, should be taught first the skills of thinking, critical thinking.
Yes.
Now this critical thinking will lead to analytical thinking. once you analyze the stuff, you go for problem solving. So now problem solving itself has got so many parameters. How do you solve the problem? So you will have to have a strategic plan. You should have your, you know, like split up the actions, like what action you are going to take, how you are going to analyze. So all these things, this completely comes under the gamut of design thinking. So that is what I feel is very, very relevant and very, very important today. So without understanding, don't do anything is my message to all my kids wherever I get chance to talk to them. So you should know what you are doing, and that's what I believe in. That's the skill set I want them to acquire.
Okay.
And in this context, what do you think is the role of the educator? What in, you know, imbibing these skills, what do you think the educator needs to do?
Okay. First of all, as I told about myself also, I am a lifelong learner and then a teacher. So the first thing, message to teachers is never give up on your learning. You have to keep continuously learning. I did my PhD when I was 50. So that it was not for any raise in the salary, or it was not for flashing my degree as doctor, nothing. I wanted to do it for my satisfaction. So if you have that passion, if you have that ambition about learning, then only you can be a successful teacher. And also the world today is changing at such a fast pace. I mean, you know, within no time you will be obsolete, especially in international education. The pedagogies change, the thinking skills change, and you know, the way we approach the subject change, newer information comes in. So in the higher classes, if a teacher goes without preparation, children will be able to pick up and give better knowledge than the teacher. That should never happen. That I would consider is like insulting thing for a teacher, because teacher has to continuously equip and continuously be prepared to answer any query. Of course, you can't know everything, but if you don't know, fine. Like, you know, teachers these days are very open-minded. They say, okay, I will come back, rather than going and beating around the bush and trying to give some answer.
Sure.
Today's teachers are, you know, they are not worried. They say, sorry, I don't know about this. Let me come back. That's a great quality again.
Absolutely.
So because nobody can know everything. Okay. True. So that wall mentality is, it will slide you down. So that is what I feel the teacher has to be a continuous learner.
Okay.
And also they need to plan their lessons very well.
Okay.
See, I've been in the industry for 35 years. I have taught subjects across. I have taught physics, chemistry, biology, algebra, geometry, mathematics, pure mathematics, and English, language and literature. But today, with all the awareness, with all the experience, with all the knowledge also, if you ask me to take a class in anywhere, any subject, I will not enter the class without preparation. I'll have to browse, I'll have to check up, and I'll have to decide what I'm going to do so that the time is not wasted. At the same time, I can introduce newer pedagogy and then make the children engaged. Today's children need to be continuously engaged, then only it is an effective learning.
Sure.
And do you think the current ecosystem is there in terms of this approach of the teacher? Self-learning, preparing, do you think it's kind of reflected?
It is actually very much reflected, especially in international schools. I'll tell you why. Because our teachers and our learners in Cambridge School, for example, okay, Cambridge International Schools, our competition is not just within India, it is with 168 countries.
Yes.
And you know, like lakhs of schools. So that itself makes, like, you know, lakhs of learners, I mean, more than 10,000 schools. So it itself is a challenge, like, you know, and today we have got lot of global communities, global teacher communities are there. And then Cambridge support system is there. We post our queries. And lots of online courses. I myself, whenever I get time, I get into Coursera and I start doing. It's a learning experience. I enjoy. So I always tell my teachers for that only. At least in international schools, it is happening.
Okay.
But let me tell you, there are also teachers in CPSE, ICSE, or even in the village panchayat schools also who are enthusiastic. Because of the internet, now they are more aware. And it's a very good sign. They are actually in the process of equipping themselves each day. This I have met at least few of them who have really shown that interest. And I believe, you know, the change is there and it is happening. To complete change, old phase change will take time, of course, but the momentum has begun.
That's great to hear. In fact, you know, the next question you've already addressed, because that was a query, was do you think there is a need for continuous and sustained development of teachers? And I think
yes.
your point
yes.
highlighted that absolutely that's a critical need.
And also, see, IB and IGCSE schools, we have a lot of professional development programs. As I told, any syllabus update is there in IB or IGCSE, immediately they get back to us and they say there is a syllabus update, so we have to train our teachers, we have to tell them.
Sure.
And you know, like Cambridge visitors come to us and they highlight what are the changes taken place and what new things are added, what things are deleted. So that development is fantastic in Cambridge schools, that I must say.
That's
I
wonderful.
Must thank the local team of Cambridge also and international team also. And also any query you post within, they say 48 hours, but I have always received their feedback within 24 hours. Whatever
sure.
queries, whatever your doubts are there, so they are that supportive. And we have school support hub also, in wherein teachers can post their questions and then, you know, they can go through the syllabuses. There are some free trainings, there are some paid trainings. It works very well with us.
So it's a combination of
yes,
the
yes.
of being the school
yes.
investing in the teacher training and teachers also kind
of
looking
course,
at their
course.
Own
of course, of course.
Meaning.
Yes.
If you have to rank the criticality of teacher training in this entire you know, aspiration to drive quality education, let's say from a grade scale of 1 to 5, where would you pitch it?
Right now, current scenario?
Yes.
Somewhere in between, couple, it could be around 3.
Okay.
Because see, when I am talking, I can't talk only about my school or few schools I know. It should be generalized completely in India.
Sure.
Which is again a lot of boards and lot of schools and all that. Maybe somewhere we have reached that 50% mark. If you are telling me 1 to 5, then somewhere at 3 we are there.
Okay.
But some schools are doing exceptionally well. But it should be made more accessible. Like, you know, I don't discriminate between teachers of international school and municipality school. Every teacher is a teacher and every teacher needs a training. And every teacher should get an opportunity to, you know, equip herself with a better ways of teaching.
So there's a very interesting point you mentioned about, you know, kind of creating the sharing platform.
Yes.
Do you think there is in this ecosystem of schools, which is not just international schools, but let's say, is there just like in corporates, you have knowledge practice sharing, best practice sharing, forums, knowledge portals. Do you think there is this ecosystem has those kind of mechanisms to drive best practice sharing of teacher training, of pedagogies, of curriculum also, that a school share? For example, recently CBSE launched an initiative of creating a learning hub, a cluster of schools together as a learning hub so that they can kind of share amongst themselves. So any perspective on that?
See, as you said, like I'm very happy to know that CBSE school has initiated, I mean, you know, board has initiated this. This already we have in the IB schools and IGCSE schools, like our Cambridge schools. Okay, what I said, the support hub, na, like teacher support hub, there you have access for all the materials, like, you know, teacher's guide is there, learner's guide is there, syllabus is there, past papers and marks, like how to mark the assessments and previously
sure.
marked papers. And plus, you know, like lot of video links. And then there is a forum, online forum, where you can post your questions, you can exchange your ideas. It is fabulous. And if something is happening in CBSE space, you know, like I would like to reach out to anybody who is looking at this, do it for all the schools, like, you know, CBA, or it's not just, should be restricted for CBSE or, you know, Cambridge schools or IB schools. It has to happen in every school, municipal
sure.
schools, SSE schools, and ICSE schools. Then that would be a big, you know, kind of revolution in the education system, I would say. If a teacher is well aware of what she is doing and if her knowledge base is good and all that is, you know, then only sky is the limit. You can grow as much as you want. There is no restriction.
Okay.
That's the thing. And also there is a community called Edmodo community on the, you know, that's especially for IB. Most of the IB teachers are there, but they don't say don't come. Others, anybody can join that community.
Sure.
And now Google Classroom also has revolutionized. Some of the villages are using Google Classrooms.
That's right.
So that's where I said it's not that only in Mumbai in a HEP school we are having this kind of technology. No, technology has reached and seeped into nook and corners of India. am very proud of it, and you know, and when we do even we can actually connect with the schools abroad. This any school can do. You know,
absolutely.
Like you will have contacts, your past pupils will be working somewhere. If the principal or the director or whoever is the head of the school becomes proactive, you can do a lot of things, whatever board doesn't matter.
Absolutely.
Like, you know, if you have an alumni who is settled abroad, most of our kids go, Indian kids go abroad. So through them, even an SSC school can have a connect, and now virtually you can get connected to them.
Absolutely.
You know, 3 years back I did a ISA project for British Council of India for one of the schools where I worked. I was working with RBK. So we had actually, you know, sessions with art sessions with the Sri Lankan school and our school, Kazakhstan school and our school. So proper sessions, like now, as I told you, the technology has brought us all together.
Yes.
You know, so virtual classrooms, virtual meetings, and that's amazing. Yeah.
Great. Okay, so we've spoken about the ecosystem, the teachers. Let's speak about you. How do you invest in yourself and your continuous development?
I don't know. I mean, if I have to tell you, I'm a kind of workaholic. You know, if I don't eat for a day, that's okay. But my brain requires fodder constantly. You know, that's how I describe myself. And any new thing fascinates me. In that way, a child in me is very, very alive. And I'm very curious. If I come to know, you know, something which I don't know, I don't, you know, stand on any formalities. I'll be after you, come on, let me know. I know, I'm so curious to learn the thing. I think if all the teachers or anybody, like, if we don't let the child in us die, then we are done.
Exactly.
You know, you don't have to go for any other thing. So knowledge is something that's so beautiful. Always I feel the world around is so beautiful, and, you know, I don't want to waste any minute. Like, I don't see any Sas Bahu serials. I don't sit and gossip. I don't spend hours on telephone, and I manage my time pretty well. If we learn to manage our time well, and also that, you know, strategic thinking is a part of my personality. Even if I have to go to a market, the minute I get into the car, mentally I visualize what all I have to buy, list is already made, and I never go back and forth also in a lane. So my mind starts working. When I make the list only, I visualize which one to buy first, then which shop comes. So that way I manage my time. So what others may take 1.5-2 hours for shopping, I finish it perhaps in 30 minutes. So 1.5 hour I gain. So in this way I manage my time very well, and I rise very early. Every day by around 4 o'clock I am up, and I sleep pretty early also.
Yes.
My early dinner between 7 and 7.30 is my dinner time, and I go off to bed by around 8.30. And meditation early in the morning and before going to bed, that really helps me. And I keep calm and manage my stuff well.
Wonderful. So, do tell us about your multi-skills that you have dabbled in, and you have kind of learned in this, you know, enriching experience of yours.
Alright. See, right from the beginning, like, I was very much inclined towards literature. That's the thing. I did my MSc. I'm a science person actually, but you know, I also did my master's in English language and literature because I love English literature. So that too, I took complete European literature and did. And so I write a lot. Right from the beginning, I'm a voracious reader. P.G. Woodhouse, Thomas Hardy, and then, you know, all this. All great writers, original writers of English I cherish. So I write poetry. Twice I was felicitated on international platform. And then, you know, I write blogs, my blog post is there, I write short stories, and I wanted to become a doctor at one point of time,
okay.
So I was doing my BHMS, then I couldn't complete, I left and I got married and got a baby, then I did my naturopathy, so I diverted into education, so fulfill that passion, I write books, and my books are available on Amazon.in. Home remedies for common ailments, and recently I have launched another book called as Mindful Conception and Gratifying Parenthood. And I do painting. Like, I'm a self-trained artist. I just study, and you know, I read and I see, and then I do on my own. So I do paintings, and now it's all in phases, like now again that phase is there. I'm painting a lot.
Okay.
And I have published about a dozen of white papers on education and on life skills and all these things. And I do a bit of journalism. I write to all the leading papers and magazines and all that. And I sing. And I have acted in plays, English, Kannada and Hindi, and theatre is my another passion.
Okay. So, is there anything else to this list?
And also I have trained a lot of children for Trinity College of London speech and drama exams.
Okay.
And art form teaching.
So you know, we write a lot that being in the education and the skill space, we always say that human advantage is going to be the differentiator, you know, in kind of setting you apart from competing with machines and technology in daily life.
Yes.
And to develop that human advantage, the core fundamental is creativity.
Yes.
And continuous learning applied in various facets of skills development. And when you were rattling off all your skills, artist, singer, writer, you know, a naturopath, you know, it's like it's so multi-skilled and multi-rounded, and being an educator, I must say that you espouse that, you know, that core fundamental of how application of creativity in various facets sets you apart and gives you enrichment for your own personal self while professional obviously happens.
If I don't sound too spiritual, I would like to say something. See, actually, the world, creators, creation is so beautiful and amazing. It's marvelous. And you know, the flowers and flora and fauna and animals who are so beautiful are unaware of their beauty and what they are contributing to the world. So why is man called the crown of creation? Because we have that ability to think and we are capable of appreciating the beauty and appreciating everything, the world around us. So, if we don't develop that, you know, quality, see, for me, life is a romance. Like, I'm a very romantic person. Romance need not be between a man and a woman only. I'm romantic about a bird I see and the surging sea I watch, and then, you know, sunrise and sunset and moonrise, anything fascinates me, you know. So, we should be enthusiastic about it and be grateful that we are born into this world and make use of that. So I go to a lot of, you know, I conduct a lot of motivational sessions and speeches for different age groups, like, you know, right from senior citizens to children. Like, I've gone across lot many things. Like, once, in fact, I had the privilege of sharing a podium with Mr. Ali Padam Singh, a fantastic,
yes,
you know, dramatist and, you know, actor.
Absolutely.
And he spoke about retirement, how to retire your lead your retired life by developing hobbies. And my session was on connecting with your own self.
Okay.
Because so many people, it is a very, especially if you are in a very high position, retirement is a very scary thing. Who will listen to me? Who will ask me like that? So it went on. So whenever I go, I tell this only. Whatever you couldn't do in your earlier life, till date, what we couldn't do doesn't matter to me. What I am doing right now, what I can do later matters to me. That's how passionately I live my life. And I convey the same message, whether it is at public gatherings I go, or whether I go as a chief guest to some function and address, whether I address my school children or class children or colleagues or even one-to-one, my message remains the same. Be passionate, be satisfied, be happy.
Very well put in today's world, absolutely. You know, you did mention that you kind of sleep early and you wake up early, and
yes,
you're excellent with time management.
Yes.
So your day is essentially 48 hours comprising of 24 hours. Why don't you describe your day for us?
Oh my God. That will be... I don't know, see, 4 o'clock once I get up, I take about 15-20 minutes to freshen up, and then I do about 1 hour meditation.
Okay.
Alright, I connect with that time. Morning time is the best time for meditation because there is no mental traffic, like, you know.
That's right.
Once you begin an active day, then your mind starts juggling what to do, how to do, and this happened, that happened. So that is the time it is cut off. And this I have been doing for the past 25 years. So it's become part of my routine. 93 is what I started. I learned so many techniques of meditation. I did Silva meditation, Silva mind control. I have done Sahaj Yoga. I have done Art of Living. Ultimately, I have concocted my own stuff, and then I did even Brahma Kumaris. So a lot of things I have done just to explore, you know, and Sadhguru's inner engineering, so many things. Ultimately, what suits best, all of them are fantastic programs, but what suits me best and for my personality and for my thing, I take up and so about 1 hour goes in that, and then I need to get ready. But you know, 1 hour in between, I squeeze in for my writing work. Any creative idea has come. So today I was in a mood like, you know, somehow like painting was on my head. So today already I have mentally mapped, because tomorrow and day after I'm going to get little time, Saturday and Sunday. Saturday, of course, I'm busy in the evening. Tomorrow